On behalf of all organizers, a very warm welcome to the second session in the Win Watson webinar series 2020. I'm Paresh Vora and I'm Director India Operations, Win Foundation. India is a very diverse geography, people and culture, and has a range of water and sanitation challenges. This requires thousands of innovations to be trialed, refined, adopted in technology and products, processes and protocols, delivery and business models. Further, ground level empowerment, managerial and technical skilling is required to enable communities and other stakeholders to adopt these innovations, often mix them with traditional methods to meet needs of a modern society. These webinars aim to showcase leading on-ground innovative projects and also spur discussions and collaborations amongst diverse stakeholders. And more importantly, take such innovations to the communities to improve their quality of life. This series is jointly organized by some of the leading institutions and social organizations in this domain, namely IIT Kharagpur. Does not require introduction. It's the oldest IIT and has an excellent School of Environmental Science and Engineering, whom we heard last week. ERIT Communities and Technologies, who are leading the session today, a leading organization working on participatory groundwater management in some of the toughest arid and saline regions in India, and now extending the work to more hydrogeological regions in Gujarat and India. SEPT University, Ahmedabad, an internationally renowned architecture and town planning university whose Center for Water and Sanitation has implemented a pioneering performance assessment system for water and sanitation service delivery in over 900 cities across 6 states in India. IIT Bombay, another leading IIT, again needs no introduction. Their Center for Technology Alternatives for Rural Areas has taken several initiatives to take technologies to rural settings. IIT Gandhinagar, a dynamic and young IIT with innovative approach to curriculum and research, and their Center for Sustainable Development is taking up challenges in several domains, including water and sanitation. And WIN Foundation, a young non-profit foundation focused on innovation for sustainable social impact in the twin domains of water and sanitation and maternal and child health. We also have a diverse audience, experienced researchers and faculty members, NGOs, industry experts, government officers, independent professionals, and enthusiastic students from India and also some from other countries. Now I have a pleasure of introducing our executive director of WIN Foundation, Mr. Ron Mehta. Mr. Ron Mehta had led industrial projects and had his own industry in plastics based in the United States, and now is executive director for WIN Foundation. He has been active in several philanthropic activities, including for IIT Bombay, IIT Gandhinagar alumni, as well as foundations, as well as several other independent philanthropic activities. We would just like to call upon Ron to speak for a few minutes about WIN's vision, how WIN's vision behind its formation. Next year, Ron.
Thank you very much, Paresh. It is a real pleasure to join this excellent webinar series on water and sanitation and innovations and empowerment for sustainable solutions. WIN Foundation, WIN itself is an acronym for WIELS India Niswarth Foundation, where NGO established in the United States by IIT alumni on the urging of the late Indian President Abul Kalam Azad. He basically challenged IITians to do something using the knowledge that they had gained in service of the mother country that they left. So about 7 or 8 years ago, WIELS was established with its spokes of water, W for water, H for health, E for education, E for energy, L for livelihoods, and S for sustainability. And about 2 years ago, I had appealed, and I have basically my passion after having retired and having sold my companies was to give back to India which has given me so much. I am an alumni like Paresh of IIT Bombay, to give back to the Indian society in assistance of problems that there are, such as for water and sanitation and in health. So we met a gentleman who is a quiet Indian billionaire here in the United States called Chirag Patel, and he agreed to form a foundation based on the principles of selflessness. That's where the N in WIN comes from, Niswarth. And we established WIN Foundation as a US nonprofit with its motto to do work in water and sanitation and maternal and child health in India. And one of the requirements of our donor, who has so far given us almost $2 million over the last 2 years, was to use the technical capabilities of elite institutions in India, such as the IITs. That is why you are seeing that in the Watson program, we have IIT Gandhinagar, IIT Bombay, IIT Kharagpur participate in various aspects of water technology and water sustainability. Along with that, we also decided that we will work with like-minded co-donors, such as Tata Power in Kutch, who had generously been supporting the work done by an excellent NGO in Kutch called Arid Communities and Technologies, or ACT. I will not delve into the details of it, but I just wanted to let you know that the principle of WIN is to first develop proof of concept and prove that the innovation works on a pilot scale before we intend to go scale and scale it up nationally across the country. So without further ado, let me pass it back to Paresh, who will introduce Dr. Yogesh Jadeja and his team. Take it on, Paresh. Thank you.
It's a pleasure to introduce the main speaker of this session, Dr. Yogesh Jadeja, founder and director, Arid Communities and Technologies, Kutch, Gujarat, India. After completing his master's and doctorate from MS University, Baroda, in geology, he started journey in water segment way back in 1993. Since 2003, he has pioneered the conceptualization and implementation of participatory groundwater management program in Kutch and then across several states. He has also guided many other NGOs across India in the PGWM process with a vision to make PGWM models replicable across India. He is the member of International Association of Hydrogeologists and also has given his services as working group member of the Groundwater in Planning Commission for the Government of India. He has authored several articles in international journals and presented in several conferences. Dr. Yogesh Jadeja is a very field level person, so he does his research probably 90% on the field and 10% in his office. So let's invite Dr. Yogesh Jadeja and let's listen to his talk.
Thank you Paresh bhai, and thank you Mr. Ron for introduction and organizing this wonderful webinar today. I'm directly sharing my screen. Today we are going to talk about the empowering the communities to apply geohydrology to sustain the aquifer. The title itself is a very interesting title, and it indicates the importance of the geohydrology as a science. But if we talk about the geohydrology means it directly links with the groundwater. And when we talk about the groundwater, that itself is an invisible resource, and how to make it visible to the community, to the users in such scenario. Because we have experienced that the many peoples, many technocrats, many policymakers have doubt about the management of the groundwater by the community itself. So we have taken it as a challenge, and we have we identify some of the community representatives to build their capacities to understand the geohydrology as a science and default the groundwater dynamics in front of their own communities and then our peoples, so that they can understand importance of the groundwater and they can plan the groundwater utilization in the wise manner, so that they can enhance or improve the sustainabilities of the natural resources and their own livelihood. So in this context, today we are going to talk about how we are studying the geohydrology and we are bringing this science to the community to bridge the gap of the knowledge as well as the decision making. So my presentation will follow in this content, this groundwater is perspective and the challenges. Why this groundwater and geohydrology science is important for us. Then the community empowerment processes and what we have learned out of this entire process and how we are going to take it at the next level. So if we look towards our country, we see the country's majority water resources is supplied by this groundwater. And if we see toward the irrigation part, it contributes about 65% of the irrigation areas of the total irrigation areas of the country, while it provides 85% of the rural drinking water supply to the rural India and about 50% of the urban drinking water of the India's need. If we look at the map of the India, you can see the red spots. All the red spots are in the arid to semi-arid regions of the India. This itself is indicating the importance of the groundwater as a climate as well as the drought resilient resource itself. But unfortunately, we don't have the sufficient knowledge system, and because of lack of this kind of the knowledge system, we are spoiling our groundwater resources, and we are converting our areas in the dark zone or the red zones as categorized by the Central Groundwater Board. By nature, groundwater is a common resource, but it is utilized highly privately. So this is one of the important challenge that we need to face. And if we see the groundwater investment for the groundwater is largely going through the community's pocket, not from the government pocket. In compared to surface water resources investment going by the investment done by the government, but in groundwater the resource and source development investment goes by the community. That's why it is highly utilized by the private manner. Then another important thing is the lack of improper information and knowledge. If you go and ask any farmer, they will simply say, if they will go deeper, they will go the more and more water. This is not fact, or this is not true. So this is another challenge that we have to take care. Then, as I mentioned, that it's a relatively more drought resilient resource in compared to surface water resource, because all surface water resources are highly rainfall dependent. Whereas in 2 or 3 year drought condition, groundwater is available in many parts of the country. All these circumstances and this another important thing, that because of lack of knowledge, lack of understanding, our regulatory framework is also not so much strong enough so that they can regulate the groundwater. All these regulatory frameworks are linked with the land resources or in the basin level. But in case of groundwater, there is no effective regulatory framework which we have. All the groundwater are managed by the district or block administrative boundary instead of the natural boundaries. As already I mentioned, the groundwater is an invisible resource and its dynamics are too much complex. So this also makes a blockage among the scientific community, that this is understanding of this kind of the resources and understanding of its dynamics is very difficult by the community. So that itself is creating a myth for the community a miss for the country that is very difficult to manage. Similarly, the limited qualified human resources. If today, if you can go and counting the human resources, the Central Groundwater Board and all the government departments may not have the qualified human resources more than 10,000 in our highly population country. So these are some challenges in front of us that when we have started the work. And if we look at the groundwater and geoscience, why? So, and the challenge we have taken only because of to demystify the myths like that only highly technically qualified people can understand and manage the groundwater. You can see this the picture and the clothing of this particular gentleman. So these are all are the rural youth. They are also able to understand the groundwater dynamics and groundwater measurements by providing some sort of the technical input. Another thing, the groundwater is unlimited and there is a river or stream feeding it. This is another myth among the groundwater users. So if you go in the arid regions like Kutch, the Kutch people normally say the Indus River is feeding our groundwater resources. So this kind of the myths are prevails in the society that also encourage the users for the exploitation of this kind of resources. And villagers cannot understand the groundwater dynamics. So all these myths are prevalent in our society. So we are trying to demystify all these myths and bring the community in the picture so that they can manage their groundwater. So for that, we have adopted an approach where we are calling the scientifying the community and socialize the scientists. So where I agree that everyone cannot understand the groundwater, but some people in the community can take a lead role and they can be useful to bridge this knowledge gap, and they can bring community or traditional knowledge to the scientists and scientifying this knowledge and again reverse back to the society so that society can utilize this knowledge for managing their resources. And that's why we are strongly focusing on building a cadre of youth from the rural area or from the groundwater user areas. So we call them the Bhujal Jankar. Bhujal Jankar are the main actor who are bridging the gap of the knowledge for the society, and they are capturing new and new knowledge, and they are providing and they are facilitating the communities and the decision makers for at the user level. So this Bhujal Jankar is one of the important capacity building aspects associated with the groundwater and empowering the communities. Then the next step after this, the experiments and demonstration phase comes, where we build the ground level evidences by holding hand with the communities, and so that the community can also feel some confidence that they can also able to manage and manage the groundwater, and they can also create the evidences to convince the other people. Similarly, then this based on this experience and all this data, then go for the community comprehensive groundwater management projects, which can deal to in all the sites, like they can deal supply management, that can deal demand management, and build a competent institution at grassroots level to provide the sustainability of the resources. Then another important step toward the community empowerment processment is development of the tools for the decision making, and all these tools are utilized by the local data and developed by the local people so that they can have confidence on this on these tools and easily adopted and follow this kind of the tools. These are the process, and in entire process the transformation through the handholding is important approach, and adaptation of appropriate practices for the groundwater management. So this is the entire process through which we are empowering the communities for the groundwater management. Now I'm going to explain about one of our important projects where we all are associated, where the Wind Foundation is associated, and IIT Bombay as well as the IIT Gandhinagar is also associated. We call this project name is a KMR. K stands for the one of the aquifer, that is Kankavati aquifer, which is a large aquifer system of the Kutch district, and it is catering water services to about 45% to 50% of the entire district. So this aquifer is spread over about more than 250 villages, and 6 towns are there, and about 26 industries are also there. So we have adopted a cluster-based approach to showcase the participatory groundwater management with the help of the community, and then MARC stands for the Manage Aquifer Recharge Through Community. So this is an example that we are going to set in front of the company, in front of the country, so that we can prove that villagers' ownership on the groundwater is also equally important, and villagers can manage their own groundwater resources. So in this process, we felt that the disrespect of the traditional approaches of the groundwater management. So we are trying to link between the traditional knowledge system as well as the advanced scientific knowledge system, and through the aquifer mapping, water security planning, water table and water quality monitoring by the Bhujal Jankars. Bhujal Jankar is a Hindi word, and I think everyone knows it. They are the groundwater informed people, so that they can collect all the data, all this mapping, and put into the in front of the community for the decision making and planning. So giving ownership by the increasing capacities and understanding of the groundwater. In this process, the training, mapping, water table and water quality measurements, and some exposures of the basic hydrological concept. So all these processes we have incorporated in the capacity building process of the Bhujal Jankar as well as the community groups. This slide shows the knowledge transformation processes. You can see the mapping process from base map is a superimposed as the revenue or cadastral map on the topo sheet. Then they go for the land use mapping, then surface geological mapping, water resource map, landform map, watershed map, strategic map. All these maps are involved three kind of the processes, like knowledge and understanding, skill development, and competence building among the community. So the entire training process passed through the theory classroom and field classes, then practicals, and the village plan as an assignment to this Bhujal Jankar. You can see the photographs also. Like in this photograph, the people are trying to understand the build the lithology of a particular well, so that in different layers of the rocks, they can easily identify the aquifer, which rock is acting as the aquifer in the well. So this process is going on. Then they go actual measurements, actual field data collection by holding the well inventories in scientific manners, and they document all this process in the form of mapping. And this kind of the seven map module is there to capture the knowledge, build the analysis, build the strategies, and for the use them for the planning. And this planning process is provide the competence to the entire community for future. Then this planning process, that the water developer water security plan will pass through some demonstration activities by forming a male and female user groups, where we are targeting the farmer groups, livestock group, even landless families are also linked with this group, and so that they can utilize the groundwater. Normally what happens in village, landless families are not have rights on the groundwater, whereas we are saying the groundwater is a common property resource and everyone has equal rights. So we are also trying to build the landless families group, and we are trying to connect their livelihood with the groundwater. Then the process take place in the sensitizing the decision makers through the demonstration, successful demonstration, workshop and seminars and exposures. So these are the process. Then after this entire exercise, go for the village or Gram Panchayat goes for the development of the tools and protocols so that they can formally manage their own groundwater. And last stage is handing over the responsibilities. Responsibility to Bhujal Jankar, responsibility to user groups, responsibility to Gram Panchayat, and responsibility to the block at district level officials for this resource management. Here we have developed some of the tools. Like this is this tool in front of you is a water security plan of an entire village. If you see in this particular sheet, there are the lots of data is there. Geohydrology science itself is there. Aquifer maps is there. Then water balance. Water balance is also there. And based on this water balance, go for the strategy for mitigating the deficit or the managing the water balance. Then identify the exit problem, and based on this problem, what are the solutions? What are the solutions for this particular village? So, with the exit location, activity, and objective of the particular activity. So, this is the process. This entire process is created by the Bhujal Jankar, led by the community, and resolved by the Gram Sabha, so that they have now planned for about 5 years to work on the ground, decentralized, work on the water management part in decentralized manner, but the people-centric attitude approach. Then the demonstration, we have carried out lots of demonstration which are focusing on the demand side management, then supply side management, considering the local geohydrological characteristic. If you can see in this picture, there is some recharge structures along with the injection method recharge. This is a river bed recharge, which is introduced during this project only. Again, this is a borewell recharge. So all these are structures are based on the geohydrological characteristic of a particular village or a particular aquifer, and then is planned and implemented or executed by the Gram Panchayat and beneficiaries. Here, we are also trying to promote some of the practices that can minimize the groundwater usage. Like we have introduced some water efficient fodder in the aquifer bed and the aquifer, then introduce the different method of the SRI method of it. There we can also minimize the water used by the practices. So there are several practices we have demonstrated, and now it is ready to adopt by the various community. But another important aspect that need to bring in the picture is a technological aspects, where we can measure our resources, extraction of our resources, and utilization of our water resources. So here we are trying to demonstrate groundwater as a common property resource, and it should be utilized by the community as a common resource. And therefore, we need to introduce some of the technologies to measure this resource allocations as well as the extraction. So we have built a formation of a group of the farmers. They are using 7 borewells collectively. There are 15 farmers using 7 borewells collectively, and now they have introduced these water meters to allocate the water from the groundwater and for their utilization. So this kind of the evidences are now ready for the community to take up, and all these implementations are very area specific activities and based on the aquifer characteristic. I must say here, the aquifer characteristics determined by the community, by the Bhujal Jankar. This kind of intervention is carried out by the community, and this kind of the innovation again are developed by the farmer group, so that it easily conveys the community of the areas. So based on this entire experience, I can say the challenge is that we have faced initial part, that the community can understand the geohydrology, but the knowledge transformation process should be specific to area, and it should be very simple. It cannot be complex one. So we have to evolve this kind of the capacity building training modules and training designs. Another important conclusion of entire process is Bhujal Jankar are the main actor. And if we can build the cadre of Bhujal Jankar, one or two Bhujal Jankar in one village or one Gram Panchayat, they can change the entire scenario of the country. In this entire process, NGOs like ours and many other organizations, they can play a very dynamic role by building capacity, then hand-holding, then mentoring, and the transformation. This process is equally important. So we are trying to build gurukuls of the Bhujal gurukuls. Those can take lead in this kind of the processes and support the community for the groundwater management. And the community institutions should have their own protocols based on the data and interpretation. We should rely on our own data and collected by the Bhujal Jankar, analyzed by the community and proven through the demonstration. This data utilize this entire experience to build the protocols, and then we can go for the governance part of this kind of the invisible resources. So now way forwards, we are thinking two way. One way is a technology, is a one another adding a technological layer to the Bhujal Jankars, like their empowerment to utilize different kind of the technical tools like soil and water testing kits. This can be easily utilized by the Bhujal Jankar and provide this data directly to the beneficiaries at the doorstep. Some advisory tools like automatic weather stations, moisture meters, and based on these tools, we can develop a good application, and that through the application, we can spread some of the information directly to the beneficiaries' hand. Then prototype designs of some of the activities that can facilitate this Bhujal Jankar as their enterprise of the localized area, and they can wrap it up in the supply side management processes. So this is the way forward that we are thinking towards the technology side. Another way forward is the decision making, like capacity building. The experiences of the ground experiences of the capacity building should go to the mainstream curriculum or mainstream development processes, so that the Gram Panchayat can have their own capacities to develop water security plans. Then establish some linkages of the stakeholders group, like farmer groups with the Krishi Vigyan Kendra and any other mainstream institution. Those can, after our withdrawal, they can take care of the sustainability. They can provide the knowledge and information, advanced knowledge and information to the communities or the community group, and develop the advisory based applications with the help of the local data collected by the Bhujal Jankar instruments. So these are the decision making tools that we are thinking to promote after this. And important for the scale up, we are targeting some of the government program recently have launched by this Jal Shakti Ministry. This Abhay is Atal Bhujal Yojana, which is exactly on the same line, where the demand management, supply management, and institution building at the grassroots level. So we are trying to develop our experience. We are trying to convert our experiences in the content, so that the participatory groundwater management can adopt by this Atal Bhujal Yojana or the Jal Jeevan missions, and then this entire approach can go for the scale up. And setting up the Bhujal Gurukul as a decentralized knowledge dissemination unit specific to respective geohydrological sub-regions of the state. So each SESH can house this kind of the 7 to 8 Bhujal Gurukuls. They can provide the knowledge and information support to the community restricted to their particular geohydrological regions. So I think that's what we have experienced, and we are trying to go ahead with the country and minimize the groundwater problems, groundwater management problems along with the communities. So in this entire process, I must acknowledge various organizational partners, like Parab is absolutely a Bhujal Jankars Private Limited company. They are providing, they are handholding with us to build a new cadre of the Bhujal Jankar in our project area. Geoscience Services, which also one of the panel member in this webinar, they are also providing the all technical support, helping the interpretation and analysis. CGPL, as already Mr. Ron has mentioned, the Tata Power is a good CSR that understand this community centric approach and supporting this entire process. Wind Foundation, there are no word to express the gratitude to the Wind Foundation. So these are my acknowledgement to all this process supported partners, and thanks for listening me and providing this opportunity to express our experiences and to share our experiences to the larger group. Thank you very much. Thank you so much.
Before we move on, Yeah, this is Paresh Vora back again. So before we move on to the next the panelist and some panel discussion, very quickly, one question which has come up, which I think it is kind of extension of this presentation, and I'll ask it right away. About Bhujal Jankar, do they need any qualification and how long is the training module? How do you select participants?
Our experience to train the Bhujal Jankar without any qualification is also there. So there are several Bhujal Jankar who never visited to school. But nowadays we are emphasizing some of the education level, like 7th standard pass, or just they should have the reading and writing abilities so that they can do reference work or the literature studies in the local vernacular language. So this is the qualification required for the Bhujal Jankar. And the selection process, we normally approach the community leaders or the Gram Panchayat or groups so that they can identify a person from among their communities. And by introduction of this kind of the selectors in this entire process is to make accountable them. After the capacity building of the Bhujal Jankar, they can utilize their knowledge and they can make sure the service is provided by the Bhujal Jankar. That's why this is the selection process of the Bhujal Jankar. And qualification wise, we don't have any barriers to train this kind, because our training method in such a way so that they can easily grasp the entire geohydrological knowledge.
How long is the training period?
Training for the water security planning is about 45 to 50 day training program divided into 7 modules, and all the modules are having a 6 to 7 day training periods, and between two modules we are keeping some gap because they need some digestion also of the knowledge. So we are not doing this kind of training as a continuous stretch.
Okay, I think we will take other questions later. Right now we'll move on to the session. Incidentally, now they have woman Bhujal Jankar also. That's a selection they're trying to diversify. I mean, have that there is a diverse background, including having women. There are women Bhujal Jankars also now. Okay, now we go on to the other panelist, and I'll give a very quick introduction to the panelists. There is Dr. Sirjina Bhimani, geologist, geosciences, which is part of ACT ERIC Communities Group. She is a very highly result-oriented professional with over 16 years experience in research, training and capacity building in the field of water resource development and groundwater management, particularly in arid areas. And she has independently handled teams working on training, planning and research projects involving this aspects. And she has ability to demystify geohydrology knowledge for capacity building and awareness. She holds a doctorate degree in geology from MS University. I'll introduce all the speakers at one go so that I don't have to come back repeatedly. We have Shuchi Vora, part of the Nature Conservancy, TNC. She manages at TNC, she manages initiatives on resilient groundwater futures and multi-stakeholder water governance. Shuchi is a conversationalist, social scientist and engineer who works at the science policy practice interface of freshwater conservation. She has over a decade of experience on a wide range of conservation issues, including urban water systems, groundwater governance and integrated water resource management. She has worked at WWF India and Hindustan Coca-Cola Beverages. She has degrees from NIT Warangal, TIS Mumbai and University of Oxford. And we have Sushmita Mandal, Program Lead Freshwater at the Nature Conservation, TNC again. TNC is world's leading conservation organization. At TNC, Sushmita leads work on freshwater ecosystems in India, focusing on water scarcity, groundwater governance, rural livelihoods, and ecology. She has over two decades of experience spanning across transboundary resources, governance, urban water management, public policy, gender and rights-based approaches. She has earlier worked with International Water Association, IUCN, Ashoka Trust for Research in Ecology and Environment, and the Foundation for Ecological Security. She has degrees from Delhi University, TIS Mumbai, and University of Cambridge. So let us welcome all three of them. And I'll hand over the mic again. Is that Sezina going first, Dr. Sezina?
Yes. Or is it? Okay. Thank you, Paresh bhai. My views on this webinar is the work presented by Dr. Yogesh Jadeja is really fantastic and path-showing work for our country. Because nowadays we regularly observed and felt that water crisis is everywhere. No any region of India is water secure. Like where there is a drought, that region also faces water scarcity. As well as the area has excess of rainfall, that also face the water scarcity. So this is regarding management of the resource. And such scarcity region, we always felt, and it is well known fact that groundwater is the only and only sustainable resource for future. So here again the question arises that we can easily understand and map the surface water, but when we talk about groundwater, definitely it is a dynamic resource and it is an invisible resource. So one cannot understand the resource in depth in scientific way. Even if I talk about myself, I have, when I have completed master's in geology, when I come to field, it was really like bhujal jankar. So even being a technocrat and studied from that field on also, groundwater requires some sort of guidance and some sort of support and handholding when you work on field. So, and second thing is that if you have done work in one region, so it is not necessary that you can easily work on another region, because groundwater is dependent on aquifer. And in India, there are seven zones we can identify as per aquifer. So each aquifer has different type of issues, each aquifer has different type of potential, every aquifer has different type of reaction with groundwater draft and groundwater recharge. So it is very much essential to understand groundwater science in respect to that region. And second thing is that groundwater is accessed by everyone. So it has large number of stakeholders. And when there are large number of stakeholders, it is very much difficult to manage the resource. And due to lack of knowledge in this stakeholder, the groundwater is not being managed properly. So for water secure future, it is very much essential to manage groundwater on field. And that work has been done by Yogesh Jadeja and team in Kutch project in Mandvi block. Even they are working since 2007-8, and at that time the thought regarding groundwater management was like a funny thought, that how can you manage the resource that we are not able to see. So the work done over here has many components, and the approach is called participatory groundwater management, and it has many components like planning, study and research, involvement of panchayats, community. And nowadays, government program like Atal Bhujal Yojana, Jal Jeevan Mission are also considering this approach. So this is to be a really a model for groundwater management for not only for Gujarat but for entire country. The most important thing I here want to take your attention is Bhujal Jankar is really a catchy word. Earlier when we were training Bhujal Jankar, we have thought like that we are just transferring knowledge into one person. But nowadays that one person can change the entire scene. So if each village has one Bhujal Jankar who have traditional knowledge as well as science in their knowledge system, so they can easily guide their panchayat, their community on groundwater recharge management, on groundwater uses and demand and supply management. So this is really a very good component, and I think it's a tool. No doubt it's a living thing, but it's a tool that we can use in entire India to manage the resources. Because whoever the techno, either it is Yogesh bhai or me, we will definitely from any region who has such type of knowledge and can be there for a lifelong, so that person can manage the resource over there. So I think the team, Dr. Jadeja and their team, has done good job in Kutch region as well as in other parts of Gujarat and other state of India. So I think I should finish here my speech and give chance to Ms. Suchi and Ms. Sushmita to speak on this point. Thank you. Thank you, Paresh bhai.
Yeah, please, Suchi, you have to unmute yourself.
Thank you, Shazina Ben, Yogesh bhai, for those words and that presentation. And thank you, Paresh bhai, for a great introduction in the start. So I would like to add a new dimension to all of that that has been spoken about, and participatory groundwater management has been critical because groundwater is a critical resource for people, and that's something that we understand very clearly, that people need groundwater for water and sanitation needs. But India is a monsoonal country. We know that with our agriculture systems, we understand that groundwater is critical for irrigation too. There's one aspect that we continuously tend to forget because it's a stakeholder that does not have a voice of its own, and that's ecosystems. In a monsoonal system, groundwater is also feeding our ecosystems, whether it's the dryland forests of central India, whether it's the tigers in Ranthambore who drink out of ponds and lakes that are formed due to groundwater supplies, whether it's leopards in Panna or the great Indian bustard that walks through the desert national park, they are all groundwater dependent species, and all these ecosystems are groundwater dependent ecosystems. Now, ecosystems also have their own carrying capacity. So the amount of groundwater that we have is limited, and that's something that Yogesh bhai had highlighted right up front. And in order to apportion that water in a way that is equitable and sustainable, we have to ensure that ecosystem water use is also met. Otherwise, we won't have water ourselves. In a few years from now, we ourselves will be out of water because we won't be apportioning that water for ecosystems too. After all, people and ecosystems are linked. We are not separate from that larger web of life. We are part of that life, and therefore we need to consider the fact that ecosystems have carrying capacity. And therefore, vegetation that requires groundwater, surface water, rivers like Godavari, there's great cultural significance that all of us have. It's called the Dakshin Ganga. It flows across 1500 kilometers across four states and has multiple national parks, has religious sites, has critical agricultural food bowls of the country. This river originates from groundwater, originates from springs, and these springs are basically groundwater coming out onto. And we have been working with Yogesh bhai and team in Nashik district in Dev, on this small river called Devnadi, which is a second order stream for it's a source point for Godavari. So it meets the Godavari right at the headwaters. And that's where we've been working to revive the river through participatory groundwater management. And we have added that additional element of ecosystems within the paradigm of participatory groundwater management. With that, I think I will hand over to Sushmita to speak a little bit more about that work and the processes within that work.
Thank you, and thank you everyone on this webinar. It's been interesting to listen into Yogesh bhai's work that I've been aware of for over a decade now, and it's been interesting to see how he has also developed that concept for all these years and has finally made it a model that can work. And in the context of the Atal Bhujal Yojana, which the Government of India has recently launched, there is a lot of scope for that kind of work to be taken forward, where it is about demystifying groundwater for communities and how through that demystification process, through that knowledge sharing and knowledge building process, we can actually make communities the stewards of this resource. But in making them stewards of this resource, the important bit that often gets missed out are also institutions and how, I mean, you have been talking about village institutions, you've been talking about community user groups, because water is a resource that gets used across very many different domains. And how do we bring all these different actors on a platform to be able to talk about groundwater? It needs governance issues to be brought to the fore. And in talking about governance issues at the fore, it is not just about building that basic framework of saying that communities have to be strengthened. Communities, by being strengthened and empowered, become part of your panchayat system. Therefore, being able to make those decisions at the local level. I mean, both Shazina Ben and Yogesh Bhai have talked about the importance of groundwater being a common pool resource. As much as we've been saying that groundwater is used in the private domain, it is a resource that is common across that geographic, the hydrogeologic unit, so to say. And within that, as Shuchi was pointing out, ecosystems become an important actor. And we and communities have to be not just talked to in terms of the ecosystem, but also in terms of groundwater and how both of them can come together to be able to manage this entire system well. Because today what we are seeing, and I think we've said enough and more about the importance and the criticality of groundwater in terms of providing for food. I mean, over 70% of the agriculture water today that is being used is groundwater dependent water. But then this groundwater, and like Yogesh Bhai was earlier pointing out, that there is this myth around how it's in Kutch that it is groundwater that is, it is the surface water that is feeding our rivers, and that's how you have to understand. But the point is, one side is, yes, there is certain amount of surface water that has linkages to groundwater. And it is ultimately, when we are talking about water in this context, in the system, in the web of life, it is the same water that is going through the entire hydrologic process. And we have to therefore be able to understand that in terms of how do we institutionally engage with it and how do we institutionally focus on managing it. That will involve and influence how we therefore manage our groundwater. I think that is another key aspect that needs to be looked at, and where really you need hybrid local institutions working in collaboration with state level, meso level. So this goes back to some of the theories that Ostrom has suggested as part of her polycentric governance mechanisms in common pool resource theory, and how, as much as so long we have looked at groundwater as a private resource, there it is time now to look at groundwater as a common pool resource and focus on how do we collectively action out so that we are able to manage and govern groundwater. I think that's one of the key things that will need further engagement. I've been looking at some of the questions and I've been thinking around that, yes, at one level it is building skills for community members to take this forward. But it is also about how do we strengthen institutions so that they are able to address the issues or the challenges vis-a-vis managing groundwater. And that will remain a key question if we are to govern our groundwater well and to ensure that not just our ecosystems remain, but our livelihoods of the rural Indian farmers who depend most on groundwater also remain. Besides several other urban centers, our health needs. If we are today talking about COVID, the entire crisis is focused on how our ecosystems are broken and therefore the jump of zoonotic diseases that's happening. So it's important that we bring all of these factors to bear upon when we are talking about water as well. And that is a key aspect that needs to be focused on as we go ahead. I'll leave it at that.
Okay, So we actually have ended a bit early, and that is very fortunate because we have a lot of questions from very interesting questions, and so we will be able to take more of them. One question I'll take an opportunity to ask myself, but Yogesh bhai, please keep the answer very small, as I would like the other questions to be answered fully. Which are other hydrogeological regions which ACT has worked on or supported others in working on? And then name one or two differences, significant difference in one or two of those hydrogeological regions.
ACT works in Gujarat, Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra, Odisha, Bihar, and Chhattisgarh. So you can see the variation from west to east. So arid semi-arid regions to rainfed areas, rainfall, heavy rainfall areas also. The differences wise, if we see, so in Kutch is an arid semi-arid regions, and the hydrogeologically the sedimentary formations are there. So sedimentary formations are shared by numbers of villages. Aquifer is a regional scale aquifer, and they requires a multiple solution and the cluster based approach. So that is one thing. As Suchi has mentioned, that we are also working in Nasik, Maharashtra. Maharashtra is a dominantly hard rock terrain, and in hard rock terrain the aquifer is very limited. If you consider an entire basin, so there you find a lots of aquifer. Even within a one village you can have the 2-3 aquifer system is controlled by the fracture system and very limited scale of the aquifer. So in that scenario we need to understand the total potential of the aquifer, and we have to go for the surface and groundwater interface between the for the utilization. We should also promote the conjunctive use of the groundwater and surface water. So aquifer properties are different in both the terrains. Rainfall pattern is also different in both the terrains, of course, and the water use practices and livelihood practices also there different there. And some external factors, like if you go in the Nasik, the people are highly motivated to go for this horticulture plants, and they require the round the year irrigation water. Whereas in Kutch, we can have the range of the people, the rain-fed farmers to the perennial irrigated farmers are there. So, this kind of the differences are there in the geohydrological condition as well as the socio-economic conditions also.
Okay, I'll quickly move on to some question, and I'll try to order them in the sequence in which it is maybe the subject is being developed. There is a question from Professor Ashwini Kumar. BJ is the key, Bhujal Jankari, the key element in this whole program, key actor. And is there any experience of them leaving this, and that causes a gap in implementation? So what is the risk of them? Them leaving this work and doing something else, and why not consider ITI candidates?
There are some experiences that the BJs have entered in this entire process, and after some time they left and they go for other livelihood part. Definitely, that's why we have started now considering some of the education qualifications of these BJs. So far ITI is concerned, ITI are having a very limited courses, and all these courses are largely services based on like electrification, mechanical jobs, etc. So this kind of the job are easily available in the markets, and Bhujal Jankar job. In case of Bhujal Jankar, they are collecting the data and providing the data. There is no value of data in our country, for especially this kind of the when we talk about this data of the society. But for the researchers, data is a high values. But this sensitivity is lacking in our entire system, and also the livelihood opportunities in rural areas. If you go in the Gram Panchayat, there are Gram Mitras. There are position of the Gram Sevaks are there. But for the Gram Sevak, they don't want this kind of the service. The Gram Sevak, they want a person who can fill the forms for the community, for the application, etc. So again, we need to create a demand for this kind of the person, this kind of the data, and this kind of the services among the society. And that's why these are the slipbacks is there. But till nowadays, because of this Abhay and some other programs, the recognition of the Bhujal Jankar is increasing day by day. And also, we are trying to tie up this entire process with the Skill Building Foundation or such kind of the government initiatives. And therefore, we need to build some collaboration with the academic institutions also, so that if they can get the certificate, they can ensure their or the secure their livelihood with the base of this their knowledge itself.
So that also answers an associated question asked by another person. I mean, Mr. Anand, that isn't it? Would it not make sense to link it to National Skill Development Corporation on, you know, for formalization? So I think you already answered that. And just to add a sentence or two to save time, I mean, we are also looking at, ACT is looking at, well, actually, maybe you can describe about the training formalization also, because of the government's need for very large scale creation of these people like Bhujal Jankar or Jaldoot or things like that.
Yeah, see, for their training, and the, nowadays the government is also pushing the groundwater management as a, one of the main agenda for the water security. So government requires an aquifer mapping in the different part of the country. So they require this kind of the skilled persons. So therefore, Central Groundwater Board has initiated 3-tier training programs. And out of this 3-tier training program, the first and second tier are directly linked with this Bhujal Jankar kind of the training. So there they can go and measure the water levels, depth of the wells, water quality, preliminary assessment of the water quality, utilization of the wells, etc. So these kind of the trainings are already initiated by the government, and these are the certificate course also. So Central Groundwater Board also provides the certificate to them. But definitely this skill building foundation, we can go for the layer-wise training, and we are seriously thinking to develop a framework for this kind of the training programs in association with this certification program, as well as we are trying to develop a lots of functional grid and contained grid for this training under this Atal Bhujal Yojana. And Atal Bhujal Yojana is having lots of resources for that, and inclination as well as the sensitivity to build this kind of the cadres. Without this cadre, Atal Bhujal Yojana may not get the success as per desire, the desired success. So these are the future directions. There we need to work strongly and embed this entire process in the mainstreaming systems.
Yeah, so what Dr. Jadeja was referring to was the, as far as qualification framework, is a national skill qualification framework. And so have programs according to that, which is a 10-layer framework. And then also there are these government schemes under which ACT is part of the consortium to define a lot of training programs and roll it out nationally along with other organizations based on the prior experience. We'll move on to the other question. There's one question by Professor Dinesh Mehta, and that's a very, he says, what is the impact of rains in Kutch on obviously on the water scenario? And I would just add a subsidiary question to it, that how has the work done in the past few years helped the areas where there has been a lot of rains?
We are fortunate that since 2 years we are receiving a good rain, and the area where we have worked, they are going to benefit by this rainfall. When we started the work, at that time there was 3 years continuous drought, and because of that drought, the water level was very low and water quality, because and it was since coastal area, the water quality was also very bad. So TDS wise, if we see, so we are having a TDS range from 4,000 parts per million to 8,000 and 10,000 at places also. But fortunately, we have carried out some of the recharge activity in some of the project areas. So they turn this saline water from 6,800 parts per million to 1,200 ppm. So it's almost in potable limit. And since last 2 years, we are observing, or in fact, we are means our Bhujal Jankari is observing this water level and water quality improvement in this entire cluster. So the whole cluster is gradually getting improved quality of the groundwater and raised water level condition. This is the one case where very thoughtful process of the planning is done, implementation has been done. But in some of the area, some activities was not carried out. So we have also lost the opportunity to tap these 2 monsoons. We don't know what will happen in the next coming monsoon. But one threat behind this good rainfall is that we may spoil our community also. The community attitude can also get changed, because the more rain, more groundwater, more water, more exploitation will also take place. So these are the other side of the coins. But definitely this year, and fortunately this year rainfall, I have never observed this type of this pattern of the rainfall since last 27 years. This was the good and very systematic rainfall, and the intensity was not so high. Normally in Kutch, the intensity of the rain in any season, 6 inch per hour is the intensity. But this time we have never seen the 3 to 4 inch or more than 4 inch intensity in a hour. So definitely all the water bodies are filled now, irrigation structures are filled now. So the lots of water is there. So we cannot say for the larger community, but definitely in clusters where this participatory groundwater management intervention has gone, because the people have now developed an attitude to go to plan the water based on the availability of the water.
There is one question by Mr. Ashim Mishra, which is, I think, a kind of similar follow-up, that any villages where the farmers, which is partly answered, any villages where farmers became self-reliant for their water requirements due to interventions by ACT through Bhujal Jankar?
Yes, there are, like in coastal Kutch, if you see, there are at least 10 to 15 villages. Now they are completely secure for their own drinking water, and farmers also, because the farmers are nowadays they have adopted a practice to recharge their defunct borewells. So now they are not wasting their water to allow out of their farm, and based on that recharge and estimation of the volume, they are now started the planning for cropping, etc.
And an extension of that question is, one is in the project villages, and what about impact on the surrounding villages who learn about it through your extension activity? What has been the impact so far?
Just defunct borewell, again I will cite the example of the defunct borewell recharge. Those we have implemented, demonstrated in our project villages, and now many villages outside of our project area are now adopting this defunct borewell recharge activities in their own farm, as well as the certain block panchayat, taluka panchayat are also now included this activity in the NREGA scheme, so that they can go for the defunct borewell recharge that owned by the panchayat or the water supply board. So this are the adaptation is now happening in the beside the project areas, or as you can say the district scale also.
So that is the impact of when a work gets done for a number of years, then there is some surrounding halo effect, and people actually ask and then try to follow. There is some one question is that any such activity in UP, Uttar Pradesh? Maybe either you can answer or Sushmita, if they know Sushmita Suchi. And what are maybe problems may not be same in UP, but related activities. Yeah, Suchi or Sushmita, you want to take over? You can turn your anything related to UP. No. Any experience of UP?
In Bundelkhand, some processes are going on. Bundelkhand, UP part of UP, Bundelkhand UP part. Some processes are going on, but that entire attempt is on the rejuvenation of the surface water bodies. And if you see the, if you can recall, the one of the IAS officer, Umakant Umravkar, he has initiated some water security processes in Bundelkhand by developing farm ponds. It's a 1:10 ratios. 1:10 ratio means if you have 10 acres of land, you can have the 1 acre of the water body in your farm so that you can secure your water resources. These are the experiences from the UP. And nowadays, I think DE and People Science Institution are trying to work in UP, and WaterAid has carried out some of the work, but WaterAid work is largely focused on the water, drinking water and sanitation part. But integrated approach is still missing in that part.
Of course, that's also UP has, I mean, the Ganges Basin and then the Punjab, the irrigated lands have other kind of problems, but we'll not, for shortage of time, we can't take this up. There is one to complete this cycle of questions. One question has come that can you show a little bit about the water security plan, because that seems to be the central element. Can you show an example of a plan, maybe on the screen or on a chart paper, and then explain few elements of it so that our readers can understand what it contains and the complexity of it?
Yeah. Is it visible?
No, you have to share your screen, I think.
Yeah, I'm sharing my screen only.
Rahul, can you? Yeah, it is probably going now. Meanwhile, you can start describing what it contains. It may take.
Water security plan contains demographic information, then geohydrological information, and some water balance. In water balance, the supply side information, input side information, and requirement of the information. See, in this particular plan, if you see the all this entire part is a village profile. Village profile is a demographic information where the human population, cattle population are there. Then the land use of the area is thoroughly mapped in the for a particular area. We are not taking the census record for this. This land use pattern is mapped by the BJ Bhujal Jankar while discussing and sitting with the villagers. Then entire mapping of the all water resources like surface water as well as the groundwater resources, use wise classification, and their complete inventory of the surface water and all the wells or tube wells in a village. Then water level information, here it is mentioned in the range, but all the information are primarily collected by the Bhujal Jankar. Then the aquifer system, shallow or the deep aquifers. Then water quality. By and large, the TDS and pH for the all the water or the groundwater samples, and some detailed chemical analysis of the some of the locations or some of the typical wells. So this information is there. Then the geohydrological characteristic. Geohydrological characteristic is interpreted, mentioned here in the form of the cross section, where it shows the two type of the aquifer. This is the one deep groundwater aquifer and shallow aquifer. This is another shallow aquifer system is there. So aquifer and water level condition and the location of the spread of the village on this entire geohydrological unit. So this information, this is mapped through this the mapping process, as I mentioned in my presentation. This information is included in the water security plan. Then the demand. in case of demand, the drinking water demand for human, drinking water demand for the cattle, then grassland development, especially considering the fodder requirement, and irrigation for the agriculture. So all this demand is estimated in the village based on this primary data. Then water supply. Water supply means total rainwater available in the watershed as well as in village areas. Then also estimation of the runoff. Out of total received rainfall, how much percentage is flowing out from the village area? That is there. Then the estimation of the ground availability of the groundwater, considering the pre scenario and present scenario, means pre to post monsoon water level data, and then the groundwater estimation, and then the map showing the locations where to work, which objective, like recharge or conservation or harvesting. So these kind of the components are included in the water security plan, and all this presented in the form of the map, village map.
Okay, I think we need to move to other questions, because this is an enormously complex process, and in fact it gets done through by Bhujal Jankar. So that's something which is more amazing, that somebody who is probably 8th standard pass, or nowadays maybe 10th or 12th, they make this plan after that training. Anyway, let's move ahead with, there are lots of questions coming in, and I will have to very quickly try to, so since it was on Bhujal Jankar, okay, we'll take that later, but Ashwani Kumar asked questions to Shuchi and Sushmita about ecosystem. How do you accommodate demand for ecosystem, you know, versus demand for human consumption, and how to strengthen formal institutions and fill the gap among them about experience on groundwater while they are having deep scientific knowledge already? So let's have a variation on people answering. So yeah, Shuchi and Sushmita, you can unmute yourself and answer this
Thank
fresh
you.
Question. Yeah.
Yes. Thanks, Parishwai. Thank you, Ashwini Kumar, for that question. It's not an easy process. I mean, to be very honest, it requires trade-offs. It requires farmers to recognize that there was a certain kind of cropping pattern because of a certain kind of hydrogeology or a certain kind of natural water availability in that area that defined why certain crops grew in certain areas. Like, for instance, water-rich areas was where various varieties of rice grew, while drier areas was where we had native cotton, millets, and other varieties which require lesser water. So there definitely is that difference which we in some ways tried to eliminate using at the time when the Green Revolution happened, and to shift back, and possibly we may not be able to shift back to a pre-Green Revolution time. But at the same time, we do need to recognize that there are these trade-offs that we need to make between how much water-intensive crops can be grown versus how much land can be left fallow versus what is that dynamic change. If it's a high water rainfall year, if we can apportion some water for ecosystems, then that definitely changes the way we work in principle with the nature. So it's essentially the difference is that, and this requires a mindset change. So when Yogesh Bhai was talking about transfer of knowledge, what the dimension that we are adding on to in this process is changing of mindsets. And this is not just changing of mindsets of communities, this also requires changing of mindsets at multiple levels, including ourselves. All of us sitting here, including ourselves, we need to change those mindsets as well. That yes, agriculture is dependent on ecosystems, agriculture will continue to remain dependent on ecosystems, and there is a carrying capacity that we need to therefore account for and make trade-offs for. And we need to be willing to make those trade-offs, with whether it's through innovative finances, whether it is through innovations in technology, or whether it is in innovations through governance. All three of these fit together and these innovations need to be made in order to account for the ecosystem, which is critical. So I think in very brief, that's my answer. If I mean, we can definitely connect offline. Please feel free to take our email IDs from Paresh Bhai and reach out to us if you want more on this.
Yeah. So I think with that, I will take anyway, Professor Ashwani Kumar is, I guess, people are in the same community. We can connect very easily. Let me take other questions also. There are two questions from Ms. Geeta Muchhala. She runs Roshni Foundation. So one is regarding, there is that she mentions that in the villages at Dhobi Ghats kind of places, people wash and then soapy water comes out. So is there any treatment that possible? She wants to work on that area. Is there any treatment possible for this soapy water so that water can then flow into soap pit or be fed to cattle or go to farms or something? Can somebody quickly take it up? Yogesh Bhai, you are aware of treatment of soapy water? So that is more of Professor Gangrekar's topic, but you can also answer it since he's probably not online. Yeah. Yes, please answer, Yogesh Bhai. Oh, you are not, you're mute. Yogesh Bhai, you have to unmute. Yogesh Bhai, you have to unmute yourself.
Yeah, I'm.
Okay, now you're audible. Please continue.
Is it okay?
Yes, please go ahead.
It shows I'm on mute.
Yes.
Yeah. There are some filtration methods are there. In fact, in Bhuj, one of our partner organization has demonstrated the devotes for this water purification. And it was a biological method is there. And there are some chemical methods also there, but I'm not aware too much about that. But DeWoods definitely helps in the purification of this water and reuse of this water, but not for the drinking water, but for other purposes. Like you can utilize for irrigation or plantation, etc.
So Mrs. Geeta Muchhala, you can also be in touch with us and we can connect you with some of our partners who work on these things. She has another very interesting question is that's related to already the work done. How do you activate defunct borewells? So they are actually recharging defunct borewells. Can rainwater harvesting with ring wells surrounding the defunct borewells recharge them? Yeah, maybe Yogesh Bhai, you can quickly answer.
See, borewell become defunct. It itself is an indicator that there was an aquifer, but it's dried. So we need not to go for the aquifer identification process, except in some of the hard rock area where people are drilling more and more wells, but they are the empty right from beginning. So we are not considering this kind of the wells as a defunct borewell, but the wells which get dried because of the depletion in the water level. So we are selecting this kind of the wells for the recharge, number one. Number two, the surrounding ring. At the filter chamber. That filter chamber is providing the filtration process that the suspended solids and some stuff that comes through the runoff water that can filter through this chamber and then pass into the water. And it goes exactly in the aquifer. So that's why this defunct borewell are functioning. And this filter chamber is consist of aggregate gravels and sand material. So all the finer particles get settled down in the filter chamber and then it passed through the borewells.
So Mrs. Geeta Muchhala, and if you want any more knowledge on this, feel free to connect offline. Yogesh Bhai is very, very willing to help any other NGOs for this process. We move on to some more questions. Mr. Alok Suri, again, a very, very senior alumnus and I think batchmate of Ron. Haryana, is just asked question, Haryana, what any activities on Haryana, Yogesh Bhai, which you are aware of?
Not now, because just today I was having some meeting with some groups, so they were also thinking how to reach out to Haryana, because the many PGWM partners are working in UP, Gujarat, Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka, but Haryana is totally left out. Haryana and Punjab, both the states are totally left out in case of the groundwater management.
Okay. There is one more question from Professor Ashwani Kumar to Yogesh Bhai. What is response of community from Rajasthan as compared to Kutch in terms of managing groundwater in their respective context of water security? I think Rajasthan also had a history of at least some Dr. Rajendra Singh and all, but maybe Yogesh Bhai would know more than me. So.
Yes, in compared to Kutch, Rajasthan response are much positive. Because Kutch, you see the Kutch being a border district and there are lots of external factors are acting in the Kutch. So that's why the responses of the community toward this decentralized management of the groundwater or water resources were more positive in compared to Kutch in the Rajasthan. And also the people are more, they are more attached with their own traditional knowledge system.
There are a couple of questions from Mr. Apurva Shah. Can you highlight role of, that's same question, it seems to be repeated. Can you highlight role of landscape into bracket plants, carbon, nitrogen, sink, etc. in terms of water retaining percolation capacity with different kind of soils and aquifer?
Yeah, it's definitely, because soil texture is a most important factor, no? If the clay soils are there, then the percolation is less, and sandy soil is there, the percolation will be high.
Yeah. I think there is one more question from Rajul. That must be Dr. Rajul Patkar and another student in IIT Bombay on BJ remuneration and how do they sustain themselves. I guess the question is how do they sustain themselves, the Bhujan Jantar system.
Yeah, there are various examples of the BJ's remuneration. Some of the BJ's are organizational worker, frontline workers, so they are getting the remuneration from there. Interestingly, in Madhya Pradesh, we got a good solution of this kind of the question. That the Madhya Pradesh, the BJ's have been recognized by the Gram Panchayat, and Gram Panchayat has passed the resolution to take their services. And they are managing their remuneration from the Mahatma Gandhi Narega scheme. So they are giving some remuneration for, let's say, 1 week remuneration to these BJs. And again, that remuneration, they are asking BJs to provide the groundwater monitoring data and helping them for crop water budgeting, this kind of thing. So these are the remuneration. And some of the BJs have developed their own enterprising unit, like as I mentioned, the Parab. Parab is a private limited company and they are offering their service to many NGOs for data collection, for the grassroots level trainings and in this way. So there are various ways, but BJ also, there are some BJs who are not in mainstream services, but they have the BJs and they are utilizing their knowledge for their own agriculture and livelihood.
Rahul, it should be sent live, somehow the live thing has stopped. Okay, I've turned it on. So there are a few more questions, so I might overshoot the time by 3-4 minutes because I think the audience is asking the question with a lot of interest. By the way, we have Dr. Anushri Malik. She is head of the Department of Rural Technologies, Rural Development and Technologies from IIT Delhi. So she is one of the person attending it. Welcome, Dr. Malik, and thank you for joining. And what are the critical factors for success of program? And PGWM program is always aligned with ecology and ecosystem, which is always uncertain. So how do we attain sustainability?
It's dynamic nature, and understanding the dynamic nature and setting up the dynamic system along with this knowledge system. So decision making based on the dynamic nature, it itself is a sustainability. So we are not focusing on the particular solution, but we are focusing toward the approach. And approach is sustainable, then it become a sustainable. I think Suchi and Susmita can also give the answer of this particular question.
anybody, you want to take a shot? Yeah, Shuji.
Yeah, I was just going to add that what I said before about understanding trade-offs is one, that's important. Two, we like to talk about something called systems thinking, which is a tool that has been developed by MIT in the 1960s, by engineers from MIT in the 1960s, and that has now kind of spread into something that can be used with communities to get the bigger picture, make the bigger picture visible. So our surface water systems, our groundwater systems, our vegetation, our soil, and our money, the source of money or the income that we get, is all connected. And it's all part of one larger system. And that's something that we make visible to the communities through this group model building exercise within systems thinking. And that we ourselves are also able to define those dynamic linkages between the carrying capacity of the ecosystem, how much rainfall, the three pillars that I was talking about, the governance, technology, and finance, how the three can be linked. If we are able to provide the right kind of incentives to farmers in a drought year to leave a certain area fallow, because we know that this year is going to be a drought year through technology, then we'll be able to identify, bring in that sustainability aspect within PGWM as a whole, and therefore aspects of crop water budgeting, demand management, implementation of technology, both at an individual level and at a collective level. And finally, most importantly, most critically, the collective decision making of communities. All of that can then encompass and work towards sustainability of groundwater resources.
Okay, I think the one question, what is the surety that, I think it's probably a follow on to that question or part of it. What is the surety that Gram Panchayat will follow the water security plan prepared for respective village panchayat when the governance of Gram Panchayat is volatile? So that, what is the answer to it? Yogesh Bhai, you want to take, or Shuchi, you want to take? Either way.
Srijina, can you answer this question? Because she is dealing with Gram Panchayat law.
So what about the dynamism and volatility of Gram Panchayat? What kind of experiences you have had? Maybe, but take only 1 or 2 minutes. I think we are now going towards the end. Yeah, please take 2 minutes.
Yes, Gram Panchayat will definitely adopt and work on this water security plan, because every village has like water related issues. And when we are supporting them, and second thing is that, as Yogesh Bhai has mentioned, that during water security planning process, community is a big part of this process, because entire planning is done by community, and Bhujal Jankar is like supporting role in this entire planning process, and our role is to demystify the geohydrology science of that region. So I think we have never faced such type of issues, because if we prepare at office level plan at office and then we submit to Gram Panchayat, then they will never take its ownership. So the main essence of this process is community participation, and it is led by themselves only. So when we prepare our plan, then there is, I think, no question about the denying of the process. Thank you.
One last question. Actually, there are a few questions on water recharge. Somebody has asked what are the various water recharge technologies. I would just answer that question saying that various water recharge technologies, for that we can actually guide you if you write to us. Write to our email ID with the question, with your name and all, and we will guide you on with various options. We'll connect you with people who are good at it, because it would take a fair bit of time to actually describe such technologies. Recharge methods. One last question from Mr. Alok Suri. My recharge pipes always get filled up with mud. Need a solution. So I think that's a filter issue, but Yogesh bhai, a quick answer.
Yes, it's a filter issue, and we have to design proper filter. That is the only solution for that.
And Alok ji, you can obviously, you are a friend, you are a very great friend of Ron, and you are our friend. So feel free to contact us, and we'll put you in touch with people like Yogesh bhai, who can, you know, actually find out and then try and help you. Thank you. I think with this we come to end of the questions. So thank you very much for attending, and I'll let Sezina to do vote of thanks. Sezina.
Yeah, thank you, Paresh bhai. As a part of Win Watson webinar series, we had today second session on water security and mainly groundwater management. So very first, I would like to thank audience and all the attendee who have attend and attend the session, and raise many thoughtful questions and lead the discussion in the right way. So I am very much thankful to all the participants and attendee. Secondly, I would like to extend thanks to organizers. IIT Kharagpur, IIT Bombay, IIT Gandhinagar, CRDF and SEPT University for organizing such a wonderful webinar series. I also would like to thank panelists Ms. Suchi Vora and Ms. Sushmita Mandal for share their time and share their experiences on this topic, and as they have very diverse experiences all over India. So thank you, Suchi and Sushmita. At last, I would like to thank Mr. Ron and Win Foundation and Win team for providing us such a wonderful platform where we can share our thought, as Kutch is a very remote area in at the western part of India, and you have taken us at a larger audience and larger scale. So I don't have any words, but I am really thankful to give us such a bigger platform to share our thoughts on groundwater management. At last, I am thank you to each and everyone who have done efforts to arrange such a great event. Thank you, everyone.
So we, I mean, she has expressed thanks, and our next session is next week, next Thursday. Rahul, you may put the slide on just to give the information. So that is just a 10 second slide for you, but really so that's our next session, where we have a session from SEPT University, efficient and equitable service delivery for urban water supply and sanitation, where the main speakers are Dr. Dinesh Mehta and Dr. Meera Mehta, Professor Emeritus and Executive Director, Joint Directors for Center and Water and Sanitation, SEPT University. Thank you very much, and see you next week.